If you find yourself in need of prayer, we want to extend you an opportunity to ask for prayer, forgiveness of sin. If you've been baptized to the body of Christ, we want you to make that choice today to consider trying Jesus today.
Amen.
Through him, salvation is found. And without him, we're absolutely nothing. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He is the Son of God.
Amen.
And the Bible says, and I believe that what is paramount, and we have to be very careful to remember that there's only one type of spirit that don't want to accept him as the Son of God. And that spirit is found in the book of 1 John, in chapter 3. That every spirit that expresses not that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist. And this spirit, as I told you before, has already gone out into the world. So the thing that we have that is synonymous, no matter where you go, are supposed to go, and anything that wears the name of Christian, is the general belief that we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Amen.
And so as you malinger through the 700 different places that call themselves church, the way you start to identify Christ as church is, number one, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
Well,
every church that says, I don't teach that, we don't believe that, you should step back from that belief system, because the warning is that this is a spirit that rejects Jesus Christ as the Son of God.
Man.
But not only can we reject Jesus as the Son of God by the way we live our lives, that we can reject him as our captain of our salvation. What do you mean by that? The Bible says in Matthew 10, verse number 32, the Bible says that if we confess him, he said we confess him, he will confess us.
Man.
The word to look at in that text is the fact that the word confession, confessing to be the Son of God, is really defined in the phraseology, the Kyrios. He is the Kyrios. And so I confess him as Kyrios, and I am doulos. And so I confess him as my master, and then I am his servant. And so if I live my life like I don't have a master, that I don't have a captain of my salvation,
uh-huh,
I cannot profess to be a child of God.
Man.
And so we have to be Christians this morning who've decided and made up their mind that Jesus is the Son of God,
man,
the author and the finisher of my soul's,
yes,
salvation. If you believe Jesus has all power in his hands, can't you shout amen? Right,
man.
If you believe he's the answer to salvation, can't you shout amen? Right,
man.
We live in a world where we have to really consider and ask those questions, because as things turn, the old soap opera says, the world turns, things are slowly changing, and people are beginning to discount the Bible, the Word of God, and everything that God has established. But I want you to know something: heaven and earth will pass away, but the Word of God
will stand forever. Man.
Amen. And so we're going to stand on God's Word. By it we shall be saved, we shall be judged at the end time. You have your Bibles, you can raise them in the air and wave them like you just don't care, just for a minute. You hold your Bibles up, amen. Some of you got phones up, I understand. As long as you don't have the bubble game on there, or I don't know, other games on there, I understand. We're in the 21st century, we have technology now. They got Bibles on watches and all kind of stuff. Okay, all right, amen. So I want you to work your Bibles this morning as we look at the text that was read into your hearings, and explore through the Word of God what he's teaching, because this is a powerful passage of scripture. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6, and let's start at verse 31. Let's read the text this morning. The Bible says, therefore, take no thought, saying what ye shall eat, what ye shall drink, wherewithal ye shall be clothed. After these things, the Gentiles seek. He assures us through his word that our Heavenly Father, he knows the things that we need. Then he says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And then he warns us again in the last verse. He says, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. In fact, he says that tomorrow have things in it that are just too powerful for you. Too powerful for you.
Man.
And I looked at this text, and I really wanted to understand the very essence of the text. Having heard it preached over and over again, I think sometimes we get so busy getting into other things of text, which are true, that we miss some of the meaning of the text that has great application to our lives. One might notice that from verse number 19 until verse number 34, there seems to be a warning to us as people about how we spend our time and what we think about and what we prioritize. There seems to be, from verse number 19, a concern about where our heart is and where our treasures is. And there seems to be a warning about how we pursue things. And it seems to be a warning over and over and over and over again. God is warning mankind, even warning us today, that we need to be careful of how we let our minds and how we let the flesh guide and direct us.
Man.
Reading a study out of UCLA and other fine institutions, there is a prediction that by 2016, that social media will take 15 hours of our day up looking at and viewing, not comprehending, things like Facebook and Twitter and all those different things that are out. That even on jobs, that time will be lost as folk are inundated with the technology from the cell phones and iPads and different things as we scarily look for more information, as we enter this rat race and try to find ways to make more money, and find the latest and the greatest thing. And the studies went on to show that while we are vigorously into the pursuit of happiness in life, at the same time, we are more sedentary than we ever have been. And that we are dying from sitting down watching TV, while TV monopolizes another half of our day just watching different programs almost religiously. And when the TV goes off, we can't even function properly. If cable was turned off, we're addicted to cable and satellite. And when it's turned off, the first thing we notice we come to the house is not if our children are home, but why isn't the TV on? And why isn't cable on? You mean cable is not on? Sure, this is the end of the world. Studies are showing that not only we're sedentary, we're not getting enough exercise, but our diets are horrible, and cancer is running just loose through every geographic and every ethnic culture that we have now. And not only that, but as we are sitting around and we're eating bad food, and we're not exercising, we're not edifying ourselves, we are growing more distant and distant from God than we ever have been.
Man.
In Europe, did you not know that only 8% of the people actually believe in some type of God? Mm. Fastly, we find that in America, where at one time almost 49 to 50% believed in some type of religion, the highest power, now it is down to almost 20% of people believe in some type of God or religion. And vastly, it has grown through atheism and every other pragmatic or pragmatic sentence that Satan has put on men, believe that there is not a God or there is not a Bible. I just reject religion itself. While at the same time they pursue and peruse all that God has made simply to find what they want to be happy.
Man.
We work hours. We spend time in different places. We find joy in being with others. And some people say that most folk now are spending half of their lifetime just trying to find one relationship after another to so-called be happy.
Mm.
It is to this end that we look at what are you doing with your time? What are you doing with your mind, and what are you feeding your mind, and even right now, what is the premise, and what are the priorities in your life? Find preachers across the nation are having deep conversations about let's go out and knock doors, because folk don't have time to knock doors. Why don't they have time to knock doors? Because they're not interested in knocking doors, and even if you use technology, they don't want to use that technology. Spend the time pursuing Christ. Arguments are held about Bible classes and studies, and not the fact that you go to church, but why spend so much time in church? There has been a change or a shift in priority in America and in San Diego this morning. And the lesson this morning is to suggest what Jesus said, and as we need to return to seeking after Christ in our personal lives.
Man.
What does this word seeking after Christ mean? It does not mean looking for Christ. It means to prioritize Christ. Share with me, if you will, we look at this text. We look at some of the translation or the rendering. When Jesus says that you are to seek after Christ, it is used as idiocratic word that is literally said, and let me tell you why it doesn't mean seek after Christ. It's for looking for Christ. Because nowhere in the text or anybody walking around looking for Christ or looking for the church. But the text over and over again, look at verse 19, it says what? Lay up not for yourselves what?
Treasures.
Upon what? Upon earth. Or moth. Where, he says where moth and rust doth corrupt. Where thieves do break through, but lay up what? Treasures in heaven. Neither where moth, rust doth corrupt, where thieves do not break in and steal. For what? For what your treasure is, your heart is. The seeking that God is required in the text is not visible. It's the mind of the individual and what he puts in his mind concerning Christ.
Man,
you can get so wrapped up in stuff going on this earth that you won't have time to think about your relationship with Christ every now and again.
Preach.
You can get so caught up in stuff on this earth where your heart is that you'll miss the sermon this morning worrying about who looking at you and what he preaching about instead of trying to listen to what Jesus is saying.
Amen.
And God is saying through his word over and over and over again that you are not to get caught up in this world, but I want you to get caught up in Jesus. Y'all not listening right now. See, the reason some of us can't get happy this morning is because we got so much on our mind there is no room for Jesus.
Uh-huh.
Have we ever sit down and thought about who woke you up this morning? Have you looked at the blessings that God has given you in spite of you? Have you looked at what God has brought you through?
Man.
Have you looked how God has been there for you when you haven't been there for him? Have you ever stopped sometime through the week and just said, thank you, Jesus, for being better to me than I've been to myself?
Yes,
he has said in the text that I want you to engulf yourself in the word. And when you got yourself in the word, when the trials and the things come, you have a remembrance that I'm the same God who has brought you through over and over and over again.
Amen.
Listen to the text. Listen to the text. Why does he say then, if you talk about somebody walking around looking for something, why does he say then in verse number 20, no man can serve, 24, no man can serve two masters. For either he shall hate the one, love the other. He shall cleave to the one. And he will reject or despise the other. He says, no man, you cannot serve what? God
and man.
Amen. There is no room for a worldly disposition and a spiritual disposition. There is no room in the mind of your mind that can function or handle the rigorous demands that God has and Satan has. God has blessings for you, but Satan can bless you too. There is no, either you are a child of God, either God is on your mind, God in your mind, or the enemy has got you too busy for God to do anything with your mind.
Amen.
We sit here and we explore within ourselves, what have you spent your time thinking about and doing this week for the kingdom of God? Therefore, he says in the next verse, take no thought for your life. He is not suggesting that you're not to think about life, because some of our great philosophers were great thinkers. Am I right about it? What we do, but that's some of the wonderful writers who have given us great expressions throughout the ages of time concerning life. James was a great writer. James says that our life is but a vapor that appeareth for a little while and then does what?
Vanish
away. Thank you, Brother Anthony. As we look at Jesus' point specifically, he is saying in the word seek, literally means in the original language, that we're not to worry about life. We're not to spend time trying to figure out life. We're not to be preoccupied with what's going on in this world. How do you know, preacher? Because the three things that we most stress about is what we're going to eat tomorrow. How many of you gotten up on your way to work and the first thing you thought about is what we're going to do for what? What we're going to do for lunch? What we're going to do for dinner? When you got to work, you got there and you said, I don't have no lunch what?
Money.
Lunch money. And then you went to work. You didn't consult Jesus. You looked at a co-worker and you asked, could you borrow some what?
Money.
Some money. You said, could I borrow how much money? If you're black, $5. Amen. Y'all know five. Y'all know something. I got what? I got
five.
On it. On it. I got five on it. I'm going to borrow $5. Or you just rolled with somebody and got in the restaurant, and you just stood by and dirty them off, And as soon as they order, you holler out a cheeseburger and fries and drink, please. And then step back when it was time to pay the bill. Amen. And that's a strategy. That's a technique that you. And then I've done it the God's way. You got to try to step back when it's time to pay the bill. Because I put some time and some energy in how I'm going to eat. And not only have I spent time and energy in how we're going to eat, but there are even some times when we'll go somewhere, particularly on a Sunday, when the church is having a meeting. We don't really care who's speaking. That's not the case at all. We want to know, is there food being served at the meeting? And if there's food being served, we want to know, is it fried chicken and what? And if it's a church known for some good food, the attendance is going to rise because folk going to get over there and get some of that food. And possibly, y'all tell the truth. What is the church known for? Chicken and pound cake. Y'all ought to say amen. Chicken and some pound cake and some sweet tea if you're inside. Amen. And so we'll miss the whole sermon. And while the preacher is preaching, we want him to hurry up and do what?
Finish.
Get through so I can get some what? Chicken.
And some pound cake
and some sweet tea. And when we get home later on that evening, we want to get a nightcap on the meal. Perhaps some of you make a run for the border. Some of you are down at the Golden Arches, and some of you have went over to Wendy's and got a $9 menu, and you can get some hot spicy chicken for $1.39. And by the time you go to bed, you ate the whole day like a barbarian bear, and now ready to hibernate in the Monday morning. Praise God. It's been all and Miss Sue.
Jesus.
Miss Jesus. All of a sudden, Miss Jesus. Jesus now is saying to them that now I want you to, but you got to get this part. Jesus now is teaching them that I know that you're hungry. Because he says in verse 32, he said, I know what you need. I know that you were created by me and you're designed to have the consumption of food. I know that you want clothes. I know that you want a happy life. I already know that. But the way you get those things is you have to engulf yourself in me. Because in me, in a righteous relationship, is your provider, the source of everything you need.
Man.
And so he said, I need you to seek ye first a relationship with me
yes.
through my word. And in my righteousness, I'm going to take care of my children. Y'all understand me?
Man.
I don't have a child who won't bless. Y'all understand me? I don't know what you're worried about, but the lesson this morning is that we need to stop worrying about stuff that God already knows we need.
Man.
Look at your neighbor and say, he already knows.
He already knows.
I don't know the devil. He don't want me to preach his lesson this morning. Did you take my water bag, Anthony? Anthony didn't take the water bag. He bought me a car a week ago, 2 weeks ago. He bought me a beautiful Volvo. And I was expecting deliverance this week. And I caught him driving this week, and he took the car back from me. So he give me something, he'll take it back, so I had to look for that water. I mean, he done took my Volvo. I got a pretty Volvo, by the way, and my brother Dale, and then he done took it back, but we're going to pray that God will touch it. And then I get to church this morning, he done bagged a 1976, diving in the back, no sunroof top, vinyl leaning in a broke bumper. See, y'all know that song. You may not have a great big Cadillac. Down in the back, sunroof top, digging the seat, and bagging it in. And I'm thinking to myself, who in the world that drove this jalopy to the Lord's house? Who in the world? Now that's just my quick show. This not even a sermon. Let's say about good spirit out. This not a sermon. But when you drove up and you saw that heap sitting there, what did y'all think? I thought it was a museum. Then it comes to the church. Hey, man, I'm going to quit this one. Let me get back to my lesson. This is a good lesson. All right, so Jesus said, seek ye first what?
The kingdom of God.
The kingdom of God. I want you to rephrase that and say, don't worry about anything but what?
The kingdom of God.
Your mind should be encompassed with what?
The kingdom of God.
And what? His righteousness. Why? Because God already knows what you need. If you're going through some troubles right now, you need to understand God already knows what you're going through. If you have a problem, you have a need right now, God knows what you're going through. The answer is not in you. It's not in how many jobs you work. It's not in stuff that you accomplish. It's not in you trying to fix it. You're going to get caught up in the rat race. God already knows what you need before you need it and has already provided for you. If you're in the right relationship with God, God will give it to you. Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
God already knows your heart has been broken.
Yes, sir.
God knows the pain you've been through. God knows what we need before we even know we need it, and has already provided it for you. All you got to do is seek what God has put for you through His Word, and God will work it out every time. Y'all understand?
Amen.
We are going to be people who are wearers of people. There should never be a Christian who's sitting around wearing. Didn't Peter say in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 7, he said, casting all your cares upon the Lord. Why? Because God cares for you. You ought not be a child of whatever something really can have on your mind. What should you do with what is on your mind?
Take it to Jesus.
Cast it to who?
God.
Cast it to the Lord. Whenever times are rough, when times are dark, God has said, I need you to count on me. I need you to trust me, because I already know what you need before you cast.
Amen.
Before you started crying this morning, before you started praying, God already knew what you needed.
Amen.
Before men had sin in the world, God already knew we needed a Savior, and already adapted and put in place everything we needed concerning salvation. He already knew that they were crucified, and before the foundation of the world, He already sent His Son down. It is not predestination, it's determination to save those that want to be saved.
Amen.
We look at this wonderful text. It says so much more than we actually read. Not only does it say stop thinking about stuff that you don't have to think about, it says stop worrying about stuff because you can't fix it no way. I don't know why you sit around, or we sit around, because I do it too. I don't know why we sit around sometimes upset, worried about stuff that we can't fix, that we can't change, when we serve the Most High God. I don't know about you, but if you really believe God like I believe God, you ought to be able to sing this song, don't worry, be happy.
Man.
Because you know that even if it don't work out like you want it to work out, God is still in control. You realize that even if things go bad, it's not bad. Because God can take what was meant for bad and make it good. Now I said, amen, Genesis 15:20. God can take the setups and setbacks and prepare you to another level. When you know God like I know God, you ought to have a trust in God.
Amen.
And the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And watch God do something in your life.
Yes, sir.
He teaches very emphatically. He says, not once, not twice, but almost five times, take no thought for them. Don't worry about things. Don't spend your time trying to keep up with the Joneses. He said, I want you to contrast something just for a moment. I want you to think about this, church, just for a moment. Look, listen to Jesus as He sets up His semantic argument, as He gives a very natural response. Jesus says that if my Father has taken care of the fowls of the air that don't have a job, if He's taking care of the lilies in the field that don't have to work the graveyard shift, praise God. If He takes care, I work the graveyard shift, so I got to get my Holy Ghost on that one. They don't have to work the graveyard shift, amen. If He takes care of the grass that simply withers away, He said, if you look at all of that God does for them, and as the lilies are arrayed, not even Solomon had something as nice as that. He said, if God does that for grass, He does that for lilies, He does that for flowers, do you not think God not going to take care of somebody He created, He loves, that have obeyed Him in the gospel of Jesus Christ? If He takes care of the foxes, Matthew 8:21, the foxes have the holes in it. Birds have the nest, but the Son of Man have no place to lay His head. Why don't the Son of Man have no place to lay His head? Because man have excluded Him from the heart of men. Where God wants to lay His head is not in a house somewhere, but God wants to lay His head in your mind.
Amen.
Let me say that again. He said in Matthew 8:21, the foxes have their holes. He says, the birds have their nests. But the Son of Man, and you listen right quick, and I want to ask you a question very quickly. But the Son of Man has no place to lay His head. Is there a place for Christ in your life this morning?
Amen.
Is there a place where Christ comes first in your life? Is there a place where you get up and say, God first this morning, and His kingdom and His will be done? Is there a time when you put God before everything else? God is looking not for the physical, but He's looking for a spiritual place to lay His hand. And I stop by to tell you that God, you're welcome to lay your hand in my heart. Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
You're welcome to put your word in my heart. David would testify, thy word
sin again?
Sin. Because if I don't have his word in the heart, then the devil will put something else in the heart. And I turn against a good God who's fed me, who's clothed me, who's provided for me, who woke me up, started me on my way, who died on Calvary's cross, who got up again on the third day, who's preparing a mansion on the other side, now empty, just waiting for me, who comes me by the graveyard,
yes,
who walked by the thrones of Jericho, who went out the villa de Rosa for my sins, and you're who bled on Calvary's cross for my sins, who prayed for me, not that I would be trapped in other churches, but in John 17 and 7, he said, Father, I pray this prayer, make them one as you and I is one. For other sheep I have, not of this fold, he says in John chapter 10, but these sheep I will bring into this fold. In John 17, he said, I want to pray that you sanctify them through your word. Sanctified by your word. Protect them by your word. Keep them by your word. Where is the word? In my heart. And if the word of God is in your heart, you're in the kingdom of God. And his righteousness, all these things you look for, shall be established.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God anyhow.
Yes, sir.
He warns, he minds, he gives a didactic scene between humanity and nature. He says, all I've done for them, I've taken care of them. Have you ever seen a bird worried about anything? As a matter of fact, the bird is so relaxed. You say, Mr. Bird, why are you so happy? He says, well, I don't need a car like you need a car. But God gave me two wings. Y'all say amen. He's flying around. He said, sometimes the air feels so good after a good worm that I find myself just soaring through the air. And I see some of you wearing. And when I see some of you wearing, because you don't know God like I know God, I just drop a little something down to remind you that God takes care of birds. Y'all like say amen. Amen. And he's not worried about, and you know what? He's not worried about you getting him, because most of the time you don't even know where it came from. Y'all say amen. The bird does not wear it, neither should who wear it. Yes. Neither should we wear it. Why? Because if God can take care of that bird,
God he can take care of us.
And you know how God is so awesome? God says to the bird, you just keep on eating and getting fat if you want to. Because the same person that you just left that package for is going to have some chicken tomorrow at 3 o'clock. It all comes back to work.